Okay, so let's begin. It gives me great pleasure to welcome our invited speaker, Véronique Cortier, who is a world-renowned researcher on security and privacy. In recent years, one of Véronique's areas of focus has been the use of formal methods to aid the design, analysis, and implementation of electronic voting systems, which is what she'll be speaking on today. Véronique completed her PhD in 2003 at the École Normale Supérieure de Cachan under the supervision of Professor Hubert Comon. Her dissertation on the automatic verification of cryptographic protocols won multiple awards in France. Véronique then joined the CNRS as a researcher at the Loria Laboratory in Nancy, where she still works as a research director. Véronique has won multiple grants and awards for her work, including an ERC Starting Grant, the INRIA Académie des Sciences Young Researcher Award, and many distinguished paper awards. She's a member of numerous conference program committees and journal editorial boards, and is the current co-editor-in-chief of the Journal of Computer Security. She advises various governmental and research organizations on topics related to voting and contact tracing, and is much sought after as a speaker at high-profile venues around the world. Even though she's several years younger than me, I've always looked up to her work, her career, and her passion, and so do many of my colleagues in the field. I'm excited and grateful that she has agreed to share her thoughts with us here at IndoCrypt 2020. So without more ado, I turn you over to Véronique Cortier.
Thank you very much for this very nice introduction. So I'm going to share my screen again. Which was it? Sorry. Okay, this one. Okay, sorry for this delay. So my talk will be about electronic voting and how to analyze them and how our formal methods can help, since I guess in this context you're more used to a cryptographic approach. So I'm going to explain how formal methods can also complement analysis, especially in the context of voting. So first, voting, why voting? So there is a lot of reasons to use voting. So one is that it's more convenient. Voters may vote for everywhere. For authorities, it's often less work because they don't need to attend actual voting booths. There are also cases where electronic voting can do more than what we can do with paper ballot. So for example, we need some automation to allow for complex tally process like preferential voting when then you decide the winners with Condorcet or STV. It can potentially be used more often. It can also comply with legal rules. For example, where voters can vote from anywhere, which can be difficult to do on paper. And in the literature now, there are many protocols that have been proposed that address various security level and various contexts. So in my talk, I'll speak about electronic voting. And this refers to two main concepts. One is voting machines, where voters attend a physical polling station and authenticate with standard means like ID cards or anything else. And then they are using a machine that is at their disposal on the voting booth. On the other hand, there is internet voting, where voters vote from anywhere, from their home. And they typically use their own computer or device, like a phone or a tablet. And so in this talk, when I speak about electronic voting, I usually mean internet voting, although the issues and some of the solutions may apply to voting machines too. But in my talk, I will focus on internet voting. So internet voting is used in various countries. For example, in France, where I'm from, it has been used to elect a part of the French deputy at the parliament. In Australia, it's probably the country that has deployed the biggest election with electronic voting, with about 300,000 votes cast by internet, which is huge. Estonia is one of the pioneers using electronic voting for 15 years now. And there's also Switzerland, Canada, a bit of United States. And on the other hand, some countries have even banned electronic voting. So for example, Netherlands has decided 12 years ago that electronic voting can no longer be used. In Germany, they have judged that some kind of voting machine are actually are judged not to comply with this constitution. And in general, it might be possible to use electronic voting or voting machine, but it must be possible for a citizen to check that the main steps of a voting process without any special expertise, which means that in practice, it's very difficult to deploy electronic voting in Germany. In Norway, they have done trials twice, and they finally stopped because voters were not confident anymore in the fact that their vote would be counted. And so just even if there was no evidence of actual attacks, just because the public could not trust the result anymore, they decided not to use electronic voting anymore. And actually, when we speak about electronic voting, we often think political election, but in practice, it's used a lot in non-political election. For example, in professional election to elect representative of unions, in association, be it political association, but also association for sport or culture, in administration council, in scientific councils. And here the stakes can be very, can really differ from very low, like a small sport association. Typically, there is no big stake, but it can be also very big association with actually potential attackers. So we need to build good electronic voting system for this kind of election too. So why is this fear? Why is it not so easy to use electronic voting? The reason is that there have been numerous attacks. So for example, recently in 2000, so last year, the Swiss, in Switzerland, they deploy a test so that it was possible for anyone to try to find flaws. And actually, they did find flaws, cryptographic flaws in the way the proof were done in the system, so that it was possible to fake the result if all the authorities were dishonest. Even much easier attacks was against the election used in Moscow last year, where they were using very weak keys, thinking that using three small keys was as good as using one keys of the same of the sum of the size, which of course is not the case, so it could be broken in less than 20 minutes. So this is just examples. There have been numerous of attacks, be it on internet voting, where voters vote from distance, or also on voting machine, for example, in US against the Sequoia machine, or also on the voting machine in India, where even though there are very dedicated devices. So if we take the problem from the other angle, so what would be a good voting system or even an ideal one? So the property we can typically think of is confidentiality of the vote privacy. No one should know how I voted. This is like the minimal property I'd like to have on a voting system. But actually, we often want a bit more than that. We want that no one should know how I voted, even if I'm willing to tell my vote. So why? Because if you think about a paper ballot, if I want to tell for who I voted, I can, but you never know whether I'm telling the truth or I'm lying. So I may tell I voted for Alice, but actually maybe I casted a vote for Bob. And this is a very important property because if I were able to prove how I voted, then I could be coerced to vote in a certain way, or I could be tempted to vote to sell my vote on eBay or some more underground place. Finally, still on privacy, there is an issue that is more specific to electronic voting, is the fact that what about in the future? So on paper ballot, if you have privacy, you have privacy. On electronic voting, privacy typically rely on cryptography, and we don't know in 20 years whether the cryptography we are using now will still be solid enough. Maybe the keys will be too small, maybe we will have found flaws in the algorithm. It's difficult to predict. So it's even better to conceive, to design electronic voting system that will be everlasting private, meaning that we can guarantee that even in 20 years, if cryptography is broken, still no one should know my vote. So this is a property on the privacy part. But again, if you think about a paper ballot election, one very important property of such system is the fact that you can trust the result, you can trust that your vote is counted. In electronic voting, this is what we call verifiability. And this is typically split into three sub-properties. One is individual verifiability. Every voter should be able to check that her vote has been counted. My vote has been counted is here on the ballot box. Universal verifiability is what you typically have on tally on paper ballot, is the fact that anyone can check that the result corresponds to the content of the ballot box. And finally, to avoid the ballot stuffing, for example, it should be the case that you have LGBT verifiability, meaning that you should be guaranteed that the ballots have been casted by legitimate voters, one per voter, typically. And the interest of having an electronic system that is verifiable is that then you don't need to trust the entire system and the computers and so on. You should just be able to verify the data of the election and have enough guarantees that your vote and that the vote, your vote has been counted, and that the result corresponds to the intention of the voter, to the intent of the voter. And even better, so it's good if it's verifiable, meaning if you detect that there is no problem, then there is none. But what happens if you detect that something went wrong? Either you can just rerun the election for small election, but for a high stake election, it's not possible. So it's better to have what we call accountability, meaning if something went wrong, the system can tell who is responsible for that, and this person can be blamed, and so is less probably less willing to misbehave if this person knows that she can be blamed for that. And there are many more properties which are less security properties, like availability. The server should be available at any time. Of course, accessibility is a big issue. The fact that it should be easy enough to use so that anyone can use it, that it is adapted to people with various issues. So this is not this won't be part of my talk, but of course, these are crucial properties for a system, and we have to make trade-off between what we'd like voters to do, like perfect cryptographers, and what we can expect from them in practice. So in the end, if I want to have a good voting system, I should be able to have a system so that I'm not able to prove how I voted, yet I should be able to check that my vote has been counted. So I need to do a balance between these conflicting properties. So to see how it can be at least partially realized, I will present a protocol that we develop in my team. So it doesn't achieve all the properties I've mentioned. It achieves confidentiality and verifiability, but no coercion resistance. So Belenius is a variant of Helios that has been designed by Ben Adida, which is itself based on JCJ. And we have a voting platform that you can use. It has been, for example, this year, so with the lockdown everywhere, there has been a big increase in the use of our platform. It has been multiplied by, I don't know, maybe 20. So this year, we have our platform has been already used for more than 2,000 elections with more than 100,000 voters. And the specificity of our system is that the ballot box is public. It's a web page that anyone can see at any time. And all the operation, in particular the tally, can be checked by anyone. So the building blocks we need as cryptography should be familiar for the attendance of this conference. So one is threshold decryption, so that each trustee computes her secret key on his own. Then the N trustees will jointly compute the public key, PK, and you need T out of N keys to decrypt, so that T out of N trustees suffice to produce the decryption. And then you set your threshold depending on, of course, the smaller your threshold is, the less privacy you have, the less number of, you need a few number of trustees to decrypt your own vote, so this might be a danger. On the other hand, the higher the threshold is, then you really need your trustee to be there, because if one is missing, if too many trustees are missing, then you won't be able to tally, to produce the result. And so there have been, of course, threshold decryption is a very well-studied field, and there are simple algorithms so that it can really be done in practice, so that the decryption key is never present on a single computer. It's really a multi-party computation. It can be done with few computation now. And the second building blocks we need is zero-knowledge proof. Again, well-known building blocks, cryptographic building blocks. And the typical proof we need are not fancy. I mean, they are easy to build. For example, we need to be able to prove that an encrypted message is either 0 or 1, either A or B, so is a valid vote, so belongs to a finite set of valid votes. And we also typically need to prove that the decryption is correct, that I decrypt and I prove that I have correctly decrypted. So this has the two main building blocks. So then how Benios works. So as I said, there is a public ballot box, a web page, where if David arrives, he can already see some ballots that have been submitted so far. And so on his own computer, he can select his choice. So to simplify here, let's say you just vote either for 0 to say no or 1 to say yes, and that's it. So there is just one question and two possible answers. And so if Dave wants to vote, he will just on his own device encrypt his choice BD with the public key of the election. And the public key of the election has been done with this threshold decryption, so that T out of N trustees suffice to decrypt. And so once the encrypted ballot of Dave is done on his computer, he will just authenticate to the ballot box, and he can check then his ballot appears on the ballot box. So he can be sure that his ballot is on the ballot box, on the public web page. Then for tally, it would be very dangerous to decrypt one by one, because then you would know how anyone voted. But in Belenius, like in Helios, you can use, for example, nomomorphic encryption like ElGamal, so that you can first homomorphically combine all the ciphertexts, so that anyone can actually compute the encryption of the sum of the votes. So that only this last ballot, the encryption of the sum of the votes, needs to be decrypted. So the authorities decrypt exactly this ballot and prove that they correctly decrypted the ballot, so that anyone can check that the result corresponds to the content of the ballot box, yet without leak, without opening any individual ballot. So as some of you might have noticed, I have simply oversimplified the protocol. So in particular, if Dave is dishonest, what he could do is either instead of voting 0 or 1 as expected, he could vote 100. Since the ballots are never opened individually, this will never be caught. And so this way, Dave would be able to vote 100 times instead of just once. so it could cheat. So of course, it doesn't work like this. What the voter should do is to encrypt his vote and prove that his vote is valid. So in this case, it's either 0 or 1 or any allowed value. Finally, another oversimplification, and this is actually one of the main differences between Ilios and Belenius, is the fact that on the ballot box, it's difficult to check whether the ballots are actually from Alice, Bob, and Chris. So there might be their name written in front of them, but in practice, in many countries, actually, it wouldn't be legal to publish widely who voted and, by the way, when, because you can just observe the ballot box. So the names are typically not written. So what you see is just a bunch of ballots. And so you don't know whether Alice voted or not. And so if the server is compromised, it would be easy for the server to just add ballots instead of voter. It would just add ballots at the place of voters that didn't vote. So for voters that abstained, the server can just place ballots on his own, like encryption of one. And this cannot be checked by external auditor. So what is done in Belenius? The authentication is someone split between the ballot box that do authentication with a standard password and login and password, and an external registrar that could be split if needed. So an external registrar actually generates a credential. This is actually signature. And what the registrar sends to the ballot box, the public verification keys, and sends to each ballot one individual signing keys. And then voters simply use this credential, so this signing key, to sign their ballots. Of course, it would be easier if voters had a PKI, but in practice, they don't. This is the reason why we're using a registrar. So voters sign their ballot with a credential, and anyone can check that indeed ballots are signed with valid credential, and now the ballot box can no longer add ballots because the ballot box doesn't have the signing keys corresponding to the public credential. Okay, so as you have seen, this is one example of electronic voting system. I've shown some attacks that you might not think of immediately, so maybe there are still attacks around. And so how to get good guarantees that a voting system is indeed a good one? So the typical approach is try to prove it, be it with a formal approach or with cryptographic models. So this is now a current practice for many protocols. And actually, in the context of voting in Switzerland, this is now even a legal requirement. So there is a law where they really write word for word that to deploy an electronic voting system at a certain level, you need to provide symbolic and cryptographic proofs of e-voting system. So it's not there is no law in English in Switzerland, so you can have it in French, in German, and Italian, I guess. Okay, so let's do a symbolic proof on an e-voting protocol. So what are the two main models that the Switzerland is referring to? There is what they call symbolic, that what I typically call formal, where messages and encryption are idealized as terms. And there is a cryptographic or computational approach, where messages are just bit strings and the encryption is the actual encryption algorithm. And in the computational approach, the adversary is any polynomial time probabilistic Turing machine. So the guarantees are typically stronger because you have a finer model with a stronger adversary. And on the other hand, the proofs are typically by hand. And it's also typically more difficult to do proof of big system because it becomes very, very hard to do by hand. And in the computational approach, there are also two sub-models, like the game-based, where you define property by property, what do you want, and the simulation-based approach, where you just define one ideal functionality that say once for all what would be an ideal system, and you have to prove that your system is as good as this one. But it's sometimes hard to prove because it's sometimes too strong, and then you need to write not so ideal functionality. But in my talk here, I'll rather focus on the formal approach. That is because I guess you are already familiar with the console one, so I'd like to explain something new to you. So in the formal approach, messages are abstracted by terms. So if you have never heard about terms, that's okay. Intuitively, a term is just a graph. So instead of having the bit string, you just remember the structure of the message. So for example, to model the encryption with some public key PK, some random R of a pair of two votes, say whatever, V1, V2, you forget about bit string, you forget about the actual crypto of asymmetric encryption. You just remember it as a structure. So this would be a tree routed with the first function, which is asymmetric encryption. This takes three subtrees, one leaf for PK, one leaf for the randomness R, that are just pure leaves. And then the last tree is a pair of two leaves, V1 and V2. So just the structure of the message is kept. Then you still need to model a bit of the primitives. They have some properties that need to be reflected. So to do this, some equations are added to the trees. So this is trees quotiented with, so terms quotiented with the equation. So for example, for pair, we typically add one functional symbol P1 that say, okay, if you project the pair on the left side, then you get X. So the projection of pair of X, Y is X. And the second projection of pair of X, Y is Y. For asymmetric encryption, this is something similar, like if I decrypt asymmetrically the encryption of X with the public key associated to Y, if I decrypt it with Y, then I get X. Okay. We can also model more involved primitives like zero knowledge proof. So for example, if I need to model the fact that I have the knowledge proof that proves that my encrypted message M is either 0 or 1, I can simply add equation saying that, well, if I have an encryption of 0 and a proof associated to this, it will return OK. And similarly, if I have an encryption of 1 with a proof associated to 1, then it will return OK. And by definition in symbolic models, any if the, for any other value, this won't return OK. So the only way I can get OK when I apply valid are these two cases. So this is for messages. And then for the protocol, typically there are many models, but typically you have a small process algebra, so like a small programming language to describe protocols. So for example, here, this is the syntax of Proverif, which is itself a dialect of the applied Pi calculus that is used a lot to model protocols. So where you have an instruction to do if then else, a let, in and out, so that you can easily say, okay, if I receive some message X that I will be stored in X on some channel C, then I proceed executing P. Or I can output on channel C some message N and proceed with protocol P. I can also create a new name, which typically would be a new nonce, a new key, and then continue. And then this weird bar and is of two parallel replication. So this is P. This is parallel composition. So P bar Q is actually P in parallels with Q. And the exclamation mark is just to a shortcut to do P parallel P parallel P parallel P, an unbounded number of times. So this is convenient to model, for example, a server that is ready to answer any request any number of times. So let's continue with the Belenius example. Let it be a very small example where you have two voters, say Alice and Bob. Each of them sends her name and an encryption of her vote. So Alice is going to vote V0, Bob is going to vote V1. So this can be a model with actually two processes. One for the process of voters that will be executed both by Alice on one side and Bob on the other side, and another process, another small program corresponding to the server that will accept the vote and finally decrypt. So the role of the voter can be written in a quite nice way, symbolically, since you can just say, okay, a voter will take as input the public key, her vote, the ID, and some authenticated channel to the ballot box. And a voter will generate some randomness, construct a ballot formed of her identity and the encryption of her vote with the randomness R. And then B is simply sent to the ballot box on the authenticated channel and then sent publicly just to reflect the fact that the adversary will be able to have access to the ballot. Then the server, so this is a very simplified model again, the server will just wait first from the vote of Alice on some the authenticated channel one dedicated to Alice, check that this is indeed Alice speaking, and record the ballot in X1. It will also record the ballot of Bob in X2, and then simply output in parallel, in any order, the decryption of the ballot. So here I'm not modeling the threshold decryption, this is a magic box, where the two votes are revealed at the same time in parallel, so that this is to model MixNet, the adversary won't be able to know which one is sent before the other one, so it's just the output of two votes in any order. So this models MixNet very abstractly, but this is to give an example of a very simple symbolic model for voting. So once we are done this, we are almost ready, except that then we need to define what it means to be secure. So let's, for example, consider privacy. What would it mean to say my protocol is private? So this is not an easy question. Actually, it's not an easy question in the cryptographic approach either. Because, so I need to say no one should know my vote, zero or one. So what I could say, what I could try to say is the attacker should not learn the value of my vote. Of course, but the issue is that, of course, he knows the value of my vote. He knows zero, he knows one. So he knows the value. So the idea is to use, like, in the game-based approach, say something like the attacker should not see the difference whether Alice is voting zero or Bob is voting zero. Okay, he should not see the difference, so he should not be able to tell whether Alice or Bob is voting. So this doesn't work either because who voted might be public. For example, in EOS, if Alice votes, then her name is displayed next to her ballot. So it's very easy to see the difference when Alice is voting or Bob is voting just because the attacker can see the name. Okay, so the next idea would be to say, okay, I don't see the difference when Alice is voting zero or Alice is voting one. There's still an issue because in electronic voting, the attacker actually sees a difference because the result differs. If Alice is voting zero or Alice is voting one, the result would be different, obviously. And this pinpoints the fact that actually there is even one case where privacy is always broken, is the case of unanimity, at least in paper ballot, with typical paper ballot. If when there is unanimity, then anyone knows how anyone voted, and this is considered as fine. While we could actually do in multi-party computation, better schemes that do not even reveal this. But in practice, but if the result function is the sum of the votes, then unanimity reveals who voted. So in symbolic models, the definition that makes more consensus is a game where the attacker should try to distinguish when Alice is voting zero and Bob is voting one from the converse scenario where the votes are swapped, where Alice is voting one and Bob is voting zero. So you can do fancier definition in the cryptographic models. Also, there is still this issue that you need to take into account that it's always the case that the results leak some information about the vote, because if the result was not were not leaking any information, then it means it's useless. I mean, you need the result to leak some information about the vote. So you have some privacy leak, and you still need to define privacy despite this. But in symbolic models, our life is pretty simple. We have decided that a good definition is this one. The adversary should not be able to make the difference when votes are swapped. Okay, so we are done in the sense that in terms of modeling, we have done most of the job. And now what I would like to explain is how tools, algorithms work to analyze protocols. So even now that I have specified the properties that I'd like to prove, I have specified my protocol. I need to prove that my protocol satisfies my property. And since I'm not doing a proof by hand, I need some automation. And I would like to have a proof for an unbounded number of sessions, so an unbounded number of voters, for example, maybe an unbounded number of elections. And for protocols in general, like TLS, an unbounded number of sessions. So the way a rule of a protocol looks like is something like, okay, if for any X, so let's take an example of voting, but if the tallyers T receive the encryption of X under the public key, then the tallyer should decrypt, at least at the end of the election, if they will agree. So this, for all X, if I receive ANC of X, blah, blah, then I answer with X. This looks a bit like first order logic. And this is actually what Proverif, one of the tools used in symbolic models. So this is what Proverif does. It actually translates processes described in the applied pi calculus into round clauses. And this is what I'm going to present now. So on the intruder part, first order logic is quite convenient and quite precise, because assume given a predicate I that models what the attacker knows, then if we want to model the fact that the attacker can encrypt, decrypt, concatenate projects, then it's very easy to write formulas like for any X, for any Y, if the attacker knows X, if he knows Y, then he knows X encrypted with Y, with the braces represent the encryption. Conversely, if the attacker knows the encryption of X over Y, if he knows Y, then he knows X. And we can add more formulas for concatenation, we can add more formulas for asymmetric encryption and other properties. This gives more formulas. Then for protocols, let's consider a very, very simple and actually bad protocol between Alice and Bob. So Bob would like to send some secret 3443 to Alice. And so Alice just said, okay, let's use my key, K Alice. And Bob receives the key, encrypts her secret with the received key and send it back to Alice. So clearly this is not a good protocol, but it's good enough to explain round clauses. So here, if I want to model these protocols into round clauses, I can just say, okay, so the attacker is going to have Alice keys anyway. So it's always true that the attacker knows KA. Moreover, as soon as the attacker knows something, a key, typically X, then he will know the secret encrypted with X, because he can just send anything to Bob and he will learn in return the secret encrypted with this anything. And then using the previous rules we have seen, of course, you will be able to decrypt and get the secret. So luckily, in Proverif, for example, in other tools, you don't need to write directly the protocols into round clauses. The tools translate the processes into round clauses for you. But this is how it works more or less internally. Okay, so now I have translated attacker in a bunch of clauses. I have translated my protocol in a bunch of clauses too. And I'd like to know whether it is secure. So assume for a very simple property that I just like to know whether my secret is secret. So here I can just add one small clause saying not the attacker should not know the secret. And then there is an attack in and only if this set of clauses is inconsistent. If it's consistent, then there is no attack. If there is an attack, clearly there will be a contradiction, so it will be inconsistent. So it's nice, it's lovely, because I have translated my my security problem into a more theoretical and well-known problem in computer science, whether a set of formulas is consistent. Well, the bad news is that actually this is undecidable. I mean, consistency cannot be decided. Okay, so should I, then what's the point? So the point is that, okay, it's undecidable, but we have a lot of techniques to still try to decide, even if it's not possible to do it in general, try to design techniques so that we can, at least in practice, decide whether the secret can be derived or not. And the very standard technique is resolution. And the idea is that you have your set of formulas and you'll just simply add logical consequences. So more formulas that are consequences from the previous one until you find a contradiction. So the technique will be correct provided you only add formulas that are indeed consequences. You don't add formulas that might not follow from the previous one. It's complete if, in case there is a contradiction, you always find it. And it's decidable if, in addition to be correct and complete, it always terminates in a finite number of steps. So for ProVerif, for example, it won't terminate. It's not guaranteed to terminate because it's not a decidable fragment. It's not even complete, not even sure that you will find an attack if there is one, but it is correct. So you don't necessarily need all three properties together to have a good system. Okay, so what is resolution? How to add consequences? So an intuitive rule is that you know from school, is that if you have a formula that say A implies C, and you have if you have A, then you can deduce C. Okay, so this can be written as if you have not A or C, and if you have A, then you can deduce C. As you have seen in my clauses, there are a lot of variables. So it might be the case that you don't have exactly not A or C and A, but something else like B. So what you can do is that if A and B are different, you can try to make them equal with what we call a unifier. And actually there is always a more general unifier, so you don't need to consider too many. So if you find, but let's say you have some theta that makes them equal by replacing the variables. So some theta such that A theta equal B theta. Then if you know that you have not A or C and you have B, if you take theta that makes A and B equal, then you can deduce C theta. Okay, so we are almost there. Then binary resolution is a slightly more complex rule. Deduction rules that say, okay, if you have not A or C and you have B or D, and if theta make A and B equal, then you can deduce C theta or D theta. And this is something that a computer can do. And we have this old theorem that say if you do binary resolution, and if in addition you consider factorization, factorization means a way to simplify formulas. So if you have A or B or C, and if theta makes A and B equal, then you can deduce A theta or C theta. So with only these two rules, then you know that if you have a contradiction, you find this contradiction only using these two rules. So this is complete. This sound, clearly, you only add consequences, and this is complete. If there is a contradiction, you'll find it only with these two rules. So this is good. So let's consider an example. So an example could be okay. So how to read this? So this is my goal. The attacker should not know the secret S. Moreover, the attacker knows some K, key one, and he also knows some message where S is encrypted with the pair K1, K1. If, moreover, I let the attacker construct pair, so for example, I have this rule that says for any X, for any Y, the attacker can build X of Y, the pair XY. If I also have a rule that says that the attacker can decrypt, if the attacker knows X encrypted by Y, if he knows Y, then he can deduce X. Well, then playing with these clauses, I can deduce a contradiction. For example, since he has K1, since he can do pairs, then he will be able to deduce, if he has Y, he will be able to deduce K1 pair with Y. So then since he has K1, he can deduce the pair K1, K1, and so on. So just playing with the rule, we get a contradiction. Okay, but this is because I knew in advance how to get a contradiction, because if I just naively apply a binary resolution and factorization, I can also have big, huge terms. So for example, if I'm very naive, I'll say, okay, the attacker, if the attacker has S, if he has, since he can construct pairs, well, he will be able to have the pair SS, and then the pair of SSS, and so on. So you have just let the computer compute all logical consequences. I have an infinite number of clauses, and it won't terminate at all, ever. So we need to design strategy with resolution to do less resolution. And one strategy is to use what is called selection function. So you can actually design any function that will tell, okay, you should rather do a resolution on this part or this part of the clause. And a selection function is any function that selects part of the hypothesis of the clause. And then you'll do a resolution on A, like if you have the clause not A or C and B or D, you'll do the resolution on A only if A is selected or if nothing is selected. And a powerful theorem is the fact that it's still sound and so it's sound clearly because you just do less resolution, so you still add only consequences, but it's still refutationally complete, meaning if there is a contradiction, so in our initial problem, if there is an attack, you'll find it doing resolution by selection. So back to tools. So in the Proverif tools developed by Bruno Blanchet, it can handle any clauses, and it is based on a resolution strategy that is well adapted to protocols with weights on the selection function that works very well in practice. In particular, it has been used to analyze many protocols, including complex modern ones like TLS or Signal. And it has been used, so back to electronic voting, it has been used to pass the Swiss requirements, for example, for the protocols developed by CITL and deployed in Neuchâtel, that is now belongs to Swiss Post, and also to another protocol, JVOTE, developed by the Geneva, And back to Belenius, Proverif can be used to prove security of Belenius, can be used to prove both verifiability and privacy. So what does this picture say? It says we have verifiability as soon as either the registrar or the voting server is honest, because if they are both dishonest, then we don't know, then the authentication, then if they are both dishonest, they can add again ballots to the ballot box, so you lose eligibility, verifiability. So that's why there is this red crosses. If both the registrar and the voting server are dishonest, then you lose, you have ballot stuffing and you lose verifiability. On the privacy side, as expected, if there is a too high number of dishonest authorities, so if the number of dishonest trustees is above the threshold, then you have no privacy because they can decrypt one by one the ballots. But if the threshold, if the number of dishonest authorities is below the threshold, then you have privacy. But the strange fact is that we can prove privacy only if we also assume the registrar and the voting server to be honest. And the reason is the fact that we realized quite late that in the existing definition of privacy, and this is true both on the symbolic models and on the cryptographic ones, they all implicitly assume an honest ballot box. So as soon as your server is dishonest, there's actually no definition. So we cannot prove privacy just because we have no definition. Although we believe it holds, at least intuitively. So to conclude first on symbolic models, the advantages of symbolic models is the fact that you have proof that can be done on complex protocols, often automatically or with some helps, but you can typically go beyond what you can do with cryptographic models by hand, just because you have these tools that can consider all the scenarios. In exchange, the cryptographic primitives are clearly modeled much more partially, since there is just some abstraction that reflects some of the obvious properties, but none of the of the math behind the primitives. And for example, for the mixnet, with a model where we just have a magic process that output the votes in parallel, you can see that we clearly abstract away a lot of the complexity of a mixnet that typically has a lot of zero-knowledge proofs to prove that the mixing is done correctly. Also, one limitation of symbolic models is that what you can prove is an all or nothing property, like a property is either true or false. So you have privacy, you have verifiability, but if some property is with some non-negligible probability, like you have some voting system where you have cast as intended, but you can catch, you have one you might have a 1/2 probability that the machine cheat each time, so that after k, the machine would have 1/2 to the k probability to add ballots without being detected, for example. So this is not something that can be captured with symbolic models. So also clearly a big issue. So I would say that in cryptographic models, the issue is to do to miss steps in the proof. In symbolic models, the issue is to do modeling error like typos or abstraction that is even more abstract than what could sort think. And also, of course, and this is again a bit like in cryptographic models, you have proof, security proof only of what you ask for. Okay, so it's important to be able to realize what you really want about your protocol. Verifiability, okay, what does it mean? Accountability, or should it be modeled? Because probably it won't say it is secure in general. It will just say it verifies this and this properties under this exact threat model. So I've spoken here about Tamarin. This is about Proverif, sorry. This is one example of a powerful tool that is used in practice to analyze voting protocols, but also more generally security protocols. And there are other tools, interesting tools in the literature, in particular Tamarin, that offer some level of interaction. So by opposition to Proverif, where it either proof or disproves the property or does not terminate. In Tamarin, when it does not terminate, you can still try to fix the proof yourself. And there are other tools dedicated to a bounded number of sessions like DeepSec and Avispass that can be convenient to prove properties. And then finally, to conclude, I'd like to conclude on voting and the limitation of Belenius. So Belenius is used in practice and offer a good level of security, yet it's internet voting, so you have no real booth, you don't know who is with the voter, so internet voting remains a form of remote voting. Moreover, in Belenius, there is no cast as intended property. So you need to trust your computer. When you click, you want to vote zero, you click on zero, you must trust your computer that it indeed encrypts zero. So there are some ways to circumvent that with, like, for example, the castor audit challenge from Benalo, but that is very hard to get right, actually, and to have voters use it in a right way. And this is an issue because, for example, so not with our system Belenius, but in the past election in France, it has been shown that it's not that difficult to design malware that would do code injection. And so when you click on zero, it actually encrypts one. So if you can't check that, then your protocol might be subject to attacks from foreign countries, for example. Moreover, another drawback of Belenius is that, as I said earlier, all the designed properties encompass resistance to vote buying and coercion resistance. And this is not the case of Belenius. Belenius offers privacy, but you, if you want, you can prove how you voted. So it's not receipt-free, and it's not resistance to vote buying and coercion. So to really conclude, the field of electronic voting offers a lot of challenges, first on verification, so in symbolic models. The electronic voting typically pushes the tools at the limits, so we need to both improve the tools, meaning the decision behind the tools, so that they can encompass larger primitives, where you need some commutation in the when the primitives have some commutation properties. We also still need to work both on the symbolic and the cryptographic side on how to formalize security properties. What does it mean for my system, for my voting system to be a good one? How to define privacy? This is not even completely finished. How to define accountability? There's still a lot of work to do there. And of course, we also need more work on electronic voting. But you know, it's just one example. There are other examples. But for each property, there is one protocol, but there is no protocol for all the desired security properties. So we need protocols that would satisfy, for example, both coercion resistance and everlasting privacy and cast as intended, possibly under less trust assumption, less trust on the authorities. Also, a more practical issue is authentication. It's not very satisfactory to authenticate voters by sending them a password by email, for example. So what kind of authentication means could realistically exist? This is still a hard problem. And of course, also, if we are able to do a system that satisfies all these properties, will it be usable if we want to make it usable? At which price for the properties? This is still an open subject. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Veronique. That was a very interesting talk. There have been some questions on Zulip that I will forward here, and I have some questions of my own. And the other panelists can, of course, also ask questions. So let me ask you, so one is a fairly precise question about slide 24. Apparently you had a variable called Z, and Mohammad Osama Sattar wants to know what Z represents, whether it is randomness or what it is.
Yeah, Z is randomness, yes, indeed, yes. Yes. I guess this one.
Yes, that's all. Yes,
yes. Good. Model randomness, which is important in voting, otherwise you can just reconstruct and check that the encryption of your vote is actually the encryption of 0 or 1. It's important that encryption is randomized.
That's great. Another question is about, in your introductory remarks, you said that electronic election voting is banned in Germany, or disallowed in Germany by law. The question is whether this covers voting machines or only internet voting or both, or what level of electronic voting is.
Okay, so I'm not a law expert, so this is my understanding of German laws, which is not so good. To my understanding, what is really illegal is some very specific model of voting machine, so some model of the NEDAP machine. Mm-hmm. But what is interesting, so this has been clearly judged as being rejected, does not comply with the constitution. But on the other hand, they say something more general that I've quoted there, that, okay, it's not disallowed in general, but if you want to use electronic voting, it must be possible for a citizen to check the main steps of a voting process with no special expertise. So then, for example, would Belenius be judged to be would be judged to satisfy this? Is it possible for a citizen to check the main steps of the voting process with no special expertise? My understanding is no, because if you want to be really sure that it works, you need to understand the protocols and zero-knowledge proof, and this is clearly not, you need some special expertise for that, or to trust experts.
Yes, yeah, makes sense. The third question is about, I guess, the trusted computing base in some sense, that we've been speaking about using ProVerif for analyzing these protocols. Well, what about the ProVerif tool itself and maybe the Bellinear software and various things? What level of assurance do we have on on these software artifacts that we're relying on?
So good question. So first on the ProVerif part, so let's say I have proved my protocols in ProVerif. Should I be happy? Should I be really, really sure that there is no flaw, at least in my protocol? So I would say no. It's some level of in assurance. So of course there might be bugs in Bellinus. There may be bugs in ProVerif. For this part, I would be rather confident that, well, the bugs that are in the design and the ones that are in the tools should not be the same. So if I think my protocol is good and ProVerif says so, I would say we have a good level of trust. But now, for sure, as I've explained, I have done some abstractions. So I didn't model all the part of my protocols. I didn't model all the cryptography. And here there are caveats in my model. And this is part that are not analyzed. And so already just for this, I cannot be completely sure that there is no flaw because there is some abstraction. And then on the Bellinus software, I start with the optimistic answer. The good part is that for a big bunch of the software, since the system is designed so that you can verify it without trusting the voting server, it means that you don't care about the fact that all the software that is deployed on our server does implement or not the protocol. You don't care because our protocol is done such that just with the data produced by the system, you can verify whether your vote is counted or not with your own software if you don't trust our software. So which is good because this is not part of the trusted code base. The what run on our system, on our server doesn't count. Yet you need to do some verification. So some are done with your own eyes, like checking that your vote appear on the screen. It's not so easy because someone you need to trust that you see the same screens and the auditors. So here there is some trust assumption. Maybe we need a blockchain, maybe not, but something like a ballot box, public ballot box that anyone see. And you need to realize this with some consensus. And you need also to check, like check the proof, check the homomorphic encryption, do the tally, check the tally by yourself. And this is part of the trusted computing base. So either you trust the software we provide to you or you write your own. And here we could, there are some works to have at least the verification tools verified in Coq, for example. So you have a verified verification algorithm.
Then somebody's going to ask a question about Coq itself, but you know, let's stop there.
Yeah.
I have a couple of questions on my own side. The first of these is a bit more technical. So in the talk, we already saw that one of the complexities of analyzing voting protocols is that even stating the security property, like you crossed out many possible security properties, is quite delicate, and it's most properties are false by default, and you have to kind of find the right definition. And that certainly makes the analysis very different from other kinds of cryptographic protocols. But the other angle that I found interesting and I wanted to ask you about was that by default, an election involves n voters, but n can be very large. And in the systems you've looked at, it requires t trustees, where t could be 4 or 5 or 6 or some number, right? So I can see that there are certain abstractions that allow you to still analyze these in some kind of bounded setting using Tamarin and ProVerif and so on. But do you think, can you say a bit more about why we don't actually have to do inductive proofs for arbitrary sets of users, of voters and trustees, and how this is actually, what is the trick that makes all of this automatable?
Mm-hmm. So the trick to make this automated, so for the voters, I would say it's easier because what we typically do is we assume 2 or 3 voters, just the small number we need to stake the properties. And all the other ones are dishonest. So we don't need to model it. They're just dishonest. And so we just need to model a server that will accept any number of voters. And in the end, after some phase or some, so you need some states in your system. After some states, the server will just output the result. But since you, what you really need to is to reason about these two, three honest voters and the rest is dishonest, this helps to just abstract them away. For trustees, it really depends. So in some cases, we just do the analysis for a bounding number of trustees, which means that in ProVerif, we can't go that far because this tool doesn't like bounding stuff. It typically explodes when you try to make it grow. In some other cases, we can, it really depends on the equational theory, but in some cases, we can still let the adversary define how many trustees he wants, how many are honest, how many are dishonest, and it can go through. But for example, in the analysis of the vote protocol, so we managed to have an unbounded number of voters, we managed to have an unbounded number of trustees, but we didn't manage to have an unbounded number of voting options. So in this system, you didn't vote just for 0 or 1, you had like a lot of questions, and you could answer to, well, you had options, and you select options. And just because the protocols were very precise on how these options were managed, and then you received return codes depending on each option, we would have needed to have like unbounded list there. And we didn't manage to
of
do
course.
That. So the true answer would be, well, it depends. Sometimes we can do arbitrary, make them arbitrary, and so we can let the tools manage the number of sessions. And some parts, sometimes we just have a parameterized analysis. So in practice, just analyze for 3, 4, 5.
Okay, that makes sense. In fact, I wanted to also make a link with your earlier answer that you gave on not having to verify the whole system with something that Rand Canetti said in his invited talk yesterday, but he was saying that sometimes maybe we don't have to verify the entire cryptographic system because cryptography itself gives us some guarantees, like maybe using zero knowledge and so on. And he was speaking in the abstract, but it looks like with Belenios and systems like this, we actually have a concrete example where the way the crypto is used is allowing us to reduce the software that actually needs to be analyzed.
Maybe I could ask a question that ties
exactly
into that. So in the context of simpler tasks like key exchange, there have been all these soundness theorems, right? Which says that if you prove something symbolically and then there is some encryption scheme that you symbolically modeled, if you replace that with the CCA secure encryption scheme, secure against chosen ciphertext attacks, then certain kinds of properties that you would prove in the symbolic model would imply certain security properties in the computational model. Mm-hmm. Have there been any sort of these kind of soundness theorems in for these kind of complex tasks like voting?
So your question is referring to the fact that in my talks, I've been repeatedly speaking on symbolic and cryptographic models. And even by the way, the Switzerland is requiring both, so a proof in the symbolic models and the cryptographic models. If we had a soundness result between both, we could just do the symbolic proofs and then apply the soundness theorem and goes for the...
Yeah, and then you replace the symbolic
components. Yeah. And we'll be done.
Yeah.
So I would say here that the main issue is really on the primitives because, what works pretty well in this key exchange protocol is the fact that you can have a very strong encryption scheme, well, very strong in CCA2, which is typically non-malleable at all. And so that the equation, abstract equation that we have in the symbolic models, we can prove them to be sound. In e-voting protocols, we typically have a bit of malleability. So we have a homomorphic encryption scheme, which is not completely homomorphic. There is a zero-knowledge proof that protects, or actually the Elgamal plus a POC protects the encryption scheme and make it an MCPA, so almost as good. But we have this part that is malleable, and it's important because it is homomorphic that you can do the tally. And this, I don't see how to prove it sound because on the contrary, I think we can prove that we'll always miss equation. And we just for Belenius, but if you think about Jvot, you have also some obvious transfer with some equation between the voting option. So I'm pretty sure we
In principle, just going back to say what Aran Kanati was talking about yesterday, if you have universally composably secure primitives for the whole threshold encryption and decryption primitive with proofs and everything, then you'd be done. It's just that that kind of a protocol may not be very user friendly, right? Everybody will let all the voters will let to come together and do something and that kind of stuff. But in principle, yeah. So if you and you want those kind of smaller modules, right? Something in which you say each voter does this thing individually. There is just a key generation that's done centrally and so forth. But so I guess that is my question. Like for those primitives, I could imagine there being some sort of a strong security definition that would suffice for some sort of a symbolic analysis, but I guess that's not been attempted, right?
Yeah, not yet. Yeah, as far as I know, it has not been tried yet.
Okay, thanks.
Are there any other questions from the panelists?
May I ask a question? Yeah. Well, it's also related to what Manoj was asking about. I know you have been doing a lot of work on algebraic properties of these encryption operators and bringing equational theories. But in the work on voting that you were talking about, can we also add full equational theories? And how would they interact with things like re-encryption and so on, which we need? Maybe this is too technical, but I think it may be realistic. Yeah.
I can try to answer. So yes, we could try to be less abstract. So here we for all the primitives, it's true in voting, we just give up and we say, okay, we abstract away any commutation property. It's not completely true. So for re-encryption, we kind of model that, but it's always, we do model some properties. As long as there remains like a subterm convergent or something that Poveri likes, which does allow equation like exponentiation, this kind of thing. And the reason why we didn't try to do it is maybe it's feasible. For example, in Tamarin, they are already adding, they do have some equation like exclusive OR and exponentiation. So I guess we can do something. But well, you already have to analyze big voting protocols that are complex. So we focus on that. And otherwise, we need first to make Proveriv grows and add some commutation property and hope that despite it will be much more complex on the equation side, it will still be able to handle the big protocols. Because already for these protocols with no equations or an equation series that is simple, the models can take hours or weeks to be verified. So that's the reason why I was not too tempted to try, but why not? I mean, maybe in a couple of years.
Curiosity, sorry.
Yeah, go on.
For the earlier question about proving Proveriv, I thought you were going to say that, people have proved computational soundness for Proveriv, within quotes, I would say. That could be an answer in itself. I mean, otherwise you can go on into, can we trust the, proof system? Can we trust the algorithms and so on? But proving computational soundness is one of the underlying package is one way of answering it also.
Yeah. And we could try to prove directly the code, like it has been done, for example, by Kartik in the earlier years. Translating directly the TLS in Proveriv, at least for some part, and then proving directly. But it's not what we have done, at least. I mean, I'm not saying it's not feasible, but it's not what we have done. So that's why, anyway, there is a gap between like the specification that is proved and the code that is run. Maybe we can improve that later on.
Yeah. Anybody else?
Yeah, I had one more quick question about, since I'm still trying to understand the lay of the land here. So you mentioned that Proveriv is, not complete and not going to, it's not deciding. But about the complete part, so for some specific thing like your Belenius, can it give a proof, say for a finite number of 10 voters, can it actually say that there is no attack, or is it just that it couldn't find any attack?
No, so when I said that problem is not complete, so problem can give you four types of answer. Either it tells you true, your property holds, then it is, probability is correct. So if you say that the property holds, this is true. Maybe you didn't model the property you wanted. Maybe you didn't model the protocol you wanted. But as written in Proverif, if Proverif answers true, the property holds, unless there is a bug in Proverif. But okay, it's not been proved correct. So this is one answer. Another answer is that Proverif finds an attack. Then you can just, okay, your protocol is flawed typically, or you didn't model it properly. And the reason why, so if this was the two answers, then it would be complete. If it's true, it's true. If there's an attack, it finds one. The reason why it's not complete is that it might also be the case that Proverif doesn't terminate. So it runs forever, and you don't know whether it will terminate eventually or not. And also Proverif can say cannot be proved, meaning, okay, for some internal abstraction, I know I won't be able to do any proof. So that's the reason why it's not complete, because it's not the case that if it's true, it will give you a proof, or if it's false, it will give you an attack. It might, and if it does, it is correct. But there is also cases where the Proverif fails to deliver any answer.
And in your case, it does terminate and say it is correct. It is, there are no attacks, right?
Yeah, after some work to tell the truth. I mean, with big protocols like this, it would be a lie to say, okay, I just write down my protocol, I press a button, and Proverif answer, yes.
Okay, so one more
adaptation.
Yeah, that I was trying to understand. So in your toy example you showed with, you know, two messages, of a protocol, then you said you had to write it in Proverif as all these conditions. Couldn't that be automated somehow? Like, you know, you should just be able to say the protocol, and couldn't you say like, oh, these are the things that the adversary sees, and there are some very basic rules about, you know, what in the algebra about decryption and encryption. And the translation from the protocol to what the adversary can do should be automatable, right?
It is. Yeah, yes. So what you write as a user is the equation. If they are standard, you can just copy-paste standard equations. That's completely fine. If you have some particular primitives in your voting protocol, you need to think about equations that would reflect them. Then you write down here the processes that describe you, the voter and then the server. And then from the specification part, you're done. Proverif will itself automatically translate it into our enclosure. Okay. And then you need to write down the properties. And this can be just, you know, the Alice vote zero, Bob vote one is indistinguishable from Alice vote zero, vote one, Bob vote zero. You can just write them as a property to Proverif and let the tool run. Then all the translation and the resolution are done automatically by the tool.
Okay, one last question. I've been asking too many questions, I guess. So you mentioned you're not, the Belenius is not receipt free, but is there even like a way that you would be able to model receipt freeness within your framework? The reason I'm asking is even in, say, the cryptographic world, you know, there is this whole model of UC security. But to model something like receipt freeness, we have other definitions like this coercion resistance. You know, it's a somewhat different kind of definition with simulators going in the reverse direction and so forth.
Yes.
Do you have, like, is there a conceivable way in which you could model receipt freeness in the symbolic world?
So good question. I mean, you're like privacy, these are properties that are really hard to model. So there are two answers. Like the first answer would be, okay, we don't have any perfect definition that everyone would accept, but there are definitions, for example, by Steve Kramer, so also the one that defines privacy, where he defines receipt freeness in a way, so maybe not general, but the idea, in a way where you change your voter, in a way so that it reveals everything to the, in one scenario, you have an honest voter that reveals everything, and another scenario, the voter fake, you know, but you know it fakes because you know your protocol, and then if both are equivalent, so then you say it's reciprocal. So there are definitions.
Okay. Yeah, so that sounds like similar to the definition in the...
Yes, they look similar. Okay. Yes, with the same caveats. Mm.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
Yeah. All right, I guess we should bring this to a close, but going, maybe we can ask Veronique to put herself out on a limb. So do you think electronic voting systems are ready to be used for large-scale elections, like the elections in India and the US and France and so on for public use? And what would it need to be in order to get there?
So my personal view on that is that we are not ready for high-stake political election. We are ready to, I would say now we have reached a level where electronic voting, if done properly, is better than postal voting, that is typically very, very bad and still used a lot in practice. For example, have a look at the American election. So here we can do better for sure. But clearly, compared to a good paper ballot election, we are not as good. And I would say, so not only we are still missing protocols that we do everlasting and cohesion and blah, blah, the two basic facts that are missing, in my view, is authentication. Maybe later on we'll have like ID cards that can do crypto and that will be satisfying for that. Maybe, and is it a good idea or not? I don't know, but maybe we can be based on that. But for example, in France, for the moment, voters receive passwords by mail or by post, and this cannot be a good way to authenticate people. And the other big issue, I think, is that most people understand paper-based voting system and they can trust them. Even though I'm trying to explain the news as well as I can, I don't think normal people can understand how the news works. And this is a real issue with democracy.
So you know, when you say it's better than postal voting, one thing I can think of which is really much riskier for electronic voting is that somebody sitting somewhere can take over the entire election. Whereas with postal votes, you really need to, go into many people's houses or post offices or something, right? To be undetectable, it's harder.
Compared to post, it depends. I think the same.
Oui, bon, c'est-à-dire, on avait juste cette seule week-end avec Anne, on a essayé
So from post, it really depends on the every. So what you are saying is that if you think about every way, if you need to attack the mailbox of every voter, it's going to be more complicated than attacking the device of every voter. But on the other hand, so this is true. But if you think about really how postal voting is done, all the ballots are then collected in a few places. And if I had to attack the system, this is where I would attack it. I would just take the ballots and put other ballots instead. So it's more decentralized than somehow than electronic voting, but not in any place. So
with Veronique's nice advice on how to steal an election, maybe this is it's a good time to end the talk. Thank you so much, Veronique.
Thank you.
Thank you, Veronique. So this brings to close all the sessions of the day. So see you all tomorrow at 11 a.m. India time or 5:30 a.m. UTC. Thanks. So I'm going to close the webinar.